Hi everyone, it's Plastic EP here, and I've got a fantastic author with me, Anthony Robustelli. He's written a great book. I want to tell you, the definitive guide to the Beatles. How are you today, Anthony?
Good, how are you doing?
Great, let's kick off the show.
Hey bananas, we think you're groovy.
We think you're groovy.
Hey bananas, we watch a movie.
Watch a movie, yeah.
Driving June buggies everywhere. Just going crazy without a care. Hey bananas,
we think you're groovy.
Hey bananas, we think you're groovy. We love to watch you cause you're our favorite show.
Hey bananas, we think you're groovy.
Hey bananas,
hey bananas, we think you're groovy.
Anthony, let's have a look at your fantastic book before we start. Here it is. I want to tell you, the definitive guide to the Beatles music, and it covers the first two albums, Please Please Me and With the Beatles. Is that correct?
That is it.
What a great cover too. That's from one of their TV appearances.
Yeah, it's one that has been lost for years, but there were a few photos of it and one of their earliest ones. So being that it's the early Beatles, figured an early shot works well.
Looks great. Now let's get straight into the book. Tell me and everyone all about it.
So it's a song-by-song companion. It covers everything from production ideas, songwriting ideas, how they put things together in the studio, things that they used on their early albums that they continued to use, songwriting techniques, things like that, that you'll see pop up through every album to the end. So it's really something that you could sit down as you're listening and go song by song and really learn everything there is to know about them.
Now, I just want to tell you, my favorite album of all time is Please Please Me. So
wow.
If I want to know, let's say, for example, I saw her standing there. What would you tell me about that song?
Well, you know, so much about that song is incredible because it started out a lot slower, a lot bluesier when McCartney first wrote it. It was called 17 and it had a really different feel. There's some early rehearsals of it where there's harmonica, just a completely different thing. Once they got into the studio, they took it in a different direction. It was sped up and copying some things from Chuck Berry bass line. And they did a number of takes of it, but they ended up going with the first one and just tagging on the 1, 2, 3, 4 from a later take. But, you know, as they found that one day that they recorded almost the entire album, sometimes the earlier takes were the best. Twist and Shout was a one-shot deal. They tried a second take that Lennon was already shot. So when you go to I Saw Her Standing There, that first take, even though they did many more, that ended up being the keeper.
I agree. And with that I Saw Her Standing There, I actually like that harmonica version, the early one. And also the actual bass line has been taken from another song. I'm talking
about you. Exactly. And McCartney even said took it right from there.
I know a bit about it, so I know my stuff. Now, tell me about the second album, the Smokey Robinson song.
Oh, one of my favorite covers they ever did, and a rare John and George lead vocal on the verses, which you didn't see much of. It was interesting that as a vocalist, George really filled in, even in those really, really early Beatle records, his third part was so important. And something like Really Got a Hold of Me, you would think that Lennon and McCartney would do the duet, but it ended up being George and John, and their voices work really well together. I feel like when they got to their second album, their choice for covers, even though it was the same 8 original 6 covers as the first album, they elevated the choice of covers, in my opinion, where the second album, they went for some deep cuts there.
I know, I like the second album, and also like It Won't Be Long. If you can go into that song, It Won't Be Long.
Oh, that's one of my favorites. Starts off the album. It was written as a possible single, and as they recorded it, they thought, you know, this is going to be our next single. But then, you know, smarter heads prevailed and they decided that it was a good album track. And the thing that was great about the Beatles is they would write songs that for any other band, it would be a hit single. And that would be where they'd be like, okay, this is the one. For them, a lot of times those ended up being, you know, in their eyes, this isn't as good as what we're going to put out as the single. So it'll be an album track. And their album tracks are always so strong because for any other band, that would be a tier one song. But for the Beatles, it was a tier two. But it still opened out the album with an amazing punch. And always loved the backing vocals on that one. The thing that's really interesting about with the Beatles album, that's when they first realized that they could really double track voices. They had only done it one instance on Please Please Me, the chorus of Taste of Honey. McCartney double tracks his vocal. They thought that was such a cool sound that, you know, as Lennon said, we almost double tracked ourselves off the album. And you had a lot of double track vocals on the With the Beatles album.
Exactly. And also, we got the George Harrison, the first song, Don't Bother Me, on the second album. What about that?
And Don't Bother Me, another classic. George had, you know, he hadn't really taken songwriting that seriously. He had written the instrumental Cry for a Shadow with Lennon, you know, many years before. But as Lennon and McCartney really started writing, it didn't really interest Harrison that much in the beginning. He was a guitarist. He was into guitars. And he was sick. They were in Bournemouth playing a show. He was sick in bed. And they had said to him, I believe it was Alan Williams, like, you know, you should write something. What are you going to write? And he ended up writing Don't Bother Me, which the interesting thing about that song is harmonically and lyrically, it's the darkest Beatles song at this point. You know, the lyrics are not happy. They're not about love. They're you know, Don't Bother Me. It says it right there. And melodically and harmonically, it's a really dark sounding minor song that the Beatles hadn't really tackled that as much. George was the first one to bring that type of depth to the songs, in my opinion.
Don't get me wrong. The song's all right for its time. I know you're going to understand it's his first song, which is fair enough. But to me, it's not really that great a song.
I mean, it's not the Lennon-McCartney caliber.
Yeah, that's right.
The thing I like about it, I think I like it more as a record than I like it as a song. I love the tremolo sound guitar, the rhythm part that Lennon plays back there. Sometimes not songs that aren't great songs make great sounding records. Sometimes the other way around. It's not where he would end up being as a songwriter with things like Taxman and Here Comes the Sun, While My Guitar Gently Weeps. Those are classic Beatles songs from anybody. But I think this is a good first shot out there as basically a non-songwriter going up against Lennon and McCartney. I think he did a pretty good job for a first time.
Which is your favorite album? Is it the Please Please Me or With the Beatles out of those two?
You know, out of those two, I would go with the Beatles. I like the sound. I love Please Please Me for its urgency. It was almost all the whole, besides the singles that were on there, the four singles, Love Me Do and Please Please Me and the Flip Sides, everything else was recorded in one day, 10 tunes. And it has this sense of urgency and it does have the feel of a live show, which is what engineer Norman Smith was really trying to capture with that, the way he mic'd the amps. Even at one point, they were thinking of recording the first album live at the Cavern, and they went and checked it out, and George Martin was like, oh, the acoustics were horrible. We would never get a good album. But they really wanted that like live energy from the first album, which I love. But with the Beatles, to me, even the originals and the choice of covers, it's a bit more sophisticated. You have things like All I've Gotta Do and It Won't Be Long. Harmonically, they're taking things a little further. And I think the mood of it, it was George Martin called it their first songbook. And there's something really to say about that. We got it as Meet the Beatles in the United States, which ended up shaving off a few songs and putting on the single, I Want to Hold Your Hand and This Boy, which was a powerful, powerful album. And that's what we always knew because that's what we got. But with the Beatles, I feel like it's, you know, Please Please Me, the next step. You know what I mean? Even though it was only recorded a few months later, you see their development so quickly.
What I want to say is, as I said, Please Please Me is my favorite. With the Beatles, is a good album. And you know about the Australian cover, don't you? John Lennon hated the Australian cover.
Yep.
Tell me what you know about that.
I don't know. I know what it looks like, and I know that he wasn't fond of it, but I don't know a lot about that.
I do. John Lennon came here.
I'd like to tell me.
John Lennon came here, and they had an EP. They had four songs with the same cover. Then they had the album with the same cover, the Australian cover. The record company here decided that that's the cover they're going to use, and it wasn't the shaded cover. It was just their four heads. And he saw it. He said, this is horrible. Why do you release this? Because he preferred the shaded heads,
of faces,
and that wasn't the case. Also, let me say, one of the greatest Beatles songs that's on the with the Beatles album is All My Lovin'. That should have been released as an A-side single and never was.
I know. It was the single that I feel like they missed out on. It is far more than a album track. I mean, it's the way they were introduced to the audiences in America. It was the first thing they sang on Ed Sullivan. It was like, hello, here we are. So they knew it was powerful, and they knew what a great song they had. And I always wonder why that wasn't a single, because it has single written all over it.
That's right, because
of McCartney's best.
Well, they used to sing it all the time in the concerts, and the girls used to get affected by that song, that they're loving him, right?
Yeah.
So it's like, you just don't know how great that song was. It's not only is it musically perfect, it's lyrically perfect from the start to the end. And the only song I can compare it to is Sorry Suzanne by the Hollies. That's another song, music perfect one.
Yep.
Just so you know.
Well, you know what?
Sorry Suzanne is perfect like that.
Yeah, I totally see what you're saying. The thing about that, I think a lot of times the Beatles, you got to think of the single at the time. It was I Want to Hold Your Hand, and She Loves You immediately prior to that. So you're thinking in between She Loves You and I Want to Hold Your Hand. Even though All My Loving's so amazing, I think in some ways the Beatles might have thought, maybe it's a little bit of a throwback with the swing thing and the walking bass line, and we want to push it forward. And I Want to Hold Your Hand felt so much more like this is what our next single should be. So you end up with these songs. That's why the albums are so fantastic, because they've never been filler. From day one, their albums were never, you have to compare those early 60s albums to what most pop groups put out at the time. It would be an album that had a single, maybe two singles, and the rest would be filler, sometimes songs written by the producer, so they can get some residuals. The Beatles never did that. They always said they wanted to give their fans also everything, that they paid for. That's why after Please Please Me, with the Beatles had no singles on it. Besides the albums that were soundtrack albums like Hard Day's Night and Help, they always put out standalone singles that, in this day and age when you can make a playlist or anything like that, I always love to take the singles that are related to the albums and tack them on to the albums, because then that gives you the full picture of what was going on at that time.
That's a smart idea. Now, also, I want to say Little Child. That's a fantastic song with a harmonica.
I love that one. It's a simple, bluesy type of song. The thing about it is the energy. I love Lennon's harmonica solo. It's very funny. If you listen to the stereo version with headphones, you could completely hear the edit where they edit the solo. And when they come back out, the reverb changes, where the panning, where the harmonica is, changes. And you actually hear the backing track just in one side. It's very interesting. But there's an energy and a fierce feeling you get from it. A lot of people have thought Lennon's vocals double track, but it's McCartney and Lennon doing a duet. McCartney was always good at doubling Lennon at times and sounding a lot like him, whereas Lennon's voice was so distinct that you always knew it was him.
I got to tell you, Anthony, you know the story about I Want to Be a Man, don't you? With the Rolling Stones, yes.
It's a great story and again, it just shows that something that the Beatles wrote for Ringo, that the Rolling Stones put it out as their single. And that just shows the levels that these bands were working on. I love the Stones, but the Stones in that time period, you know, they Jagger and Richards weren't the songwriters that they would become. And they're going over to Lennon and McCartney, seeing what they have that they could release as a second single. And basically they finished it in front of them and gave it to them. You know, they took a very different take on it, but it ended up for the Beatles, it became a Ringo song. But the Stones, exactly. It was their single.
It's but amazing. The story, John said later, you didn't think we were going to give him one of our A-sides, did you?
Yeah, of course not. You know, you think of all the people that covered Beatles songs, especially in 63 and 64, when Brian Epstein was putting them out there as songwriters, all the songs that Billy J. Kramer covered, like all the people,
exactly.
They were never giving them their hits.
No, but Billy J. Kramer, one of the greatest singers, artists, and what he did on those songs, From a Window.
Oh, he did a great
unbelievable
job.
Unbelievable, yep. What he did. He made them hits.
And again, like, they are really good songs, even though for the Beatles, they were not at all what they thought were top tier.
But you know, to me, that's a good artist.
And they had hit singles with them as well. Which is amazing that the Beatles are like, we don't really need this song. We'll give it to Billy. And then Billy's having top 10 hits with their throwaways. It's incredible.
Yeah, but the best one is when they did How Do You Do It. George Martin found it and said it's a hit song. And they go, we're not going to Liverpool with that song. We can't record that song and turn up in Liverpool. What are they going to think? So that
I know.
George Martin still made them record it. And he comes along,
and
Jerry.
I think they did a good version of it.
And he comes along, Jerry and the Pacemakers.
Yep, Jerry and the Pacemakers had a number one hit with it. So George Martin didn't know what he was talking about when he knew what the hit would be. The Beatles just didn't want it to be their hit.
But the fantastic thing is, Jerry just got the demo given to him from George. There wasn't much to do. And they recorded it, and bang, three number ones in a row they had.
I know. And the thing that's interesting is when you listen to the Beatles version in comparison to what they were given, the Beatles did add a few like little tasty chord changes and riffs and the way they harmonized. They definitely made it their own. And then Jerry took that and said, you know, this has already been arranged fantastically. I'll just roll with this. And, you know, then he's having hits left and right.
John offered him another song, and he goes, no, I'm going to write mine.
Yep.
And you know the other story? You know the other story? Frankie Goes to Hollywood had three number ones in a row.
Okay.
And he did a Jerry song.
Really?
And then Jerry went to his bank account, and there was like $300,000 there, I heard, in his bank account. He goes, thank you.
Yeah, exactly. You know what? They started to realize that I think bands, because of the Beatles, realized, wait a second, we don't need to keep going to Tin Pan Alley and recording other people's songs, and they're making a ton of money on it. We need to write our own. That's why Jagger and Richards, they didn't even think of themselves as songwriters until Andrew Lou Goldham was like, you go in this room and you write a song and you're not coming out until you write a song, because you need to be self-supporting. You need to write your own material. And they became fantastic songwriters. But even like Pete Townsend in the beginning, he didn't think of himself as a songwriter. And I think everybody looked to Lennon and McCartney and realized, wait a second, they're doing this. They're doing this really well. Maybe this is something we need to investigate.
Well, it all comes down to money. Now, I just want to go back to your fantastic book. Tell everybody where they can actually get it from, the best places to get it.
They can get it on Amazon. They can get it as a Kindle on Amazon. If they want a signed copy, they could go to the website, thebeatlesiwanttotellyou.com, and they can find out more information about that and my podcast and, you know, anything else that's going on right now. And they could buy a book directly from there, and I could sign it and send it out.
That's great. And they can't buy it direct from you, can they?
They can, yeah, at thebeatlesiwanttotellyou.com.
You know, Anthony, it's been fascinating. You're covering two of the albums that I like, but as I said, my number one album is Please Please Me because of that rawness. Even though it's polished, it's raw. It was meant to be their stage act at the Cavern at that time. And that's what George wanted. He wanted them to do their stage act. And basically, that's their introduction to the world. And that's why without that album, they would have gone they wouldn't have gone anywhere. That's why for me, that's such an important album.
It is for a band to come out with an album at that time that had 8 original songs on it. It blew the world. You know, they had their great covers. They were punchy. It was a great sounding album too. The engineers at EMI, it sounds so modern even today when you put it on. It doesn't sound like it's recorded in 1963. And their vocals just screaming. There are the little vocal mistakes. It sounds like a live show, but with great recording quality. And it was their introduction to the world. And without that album, I don't think we would have had any of the others.
Thank you, Anthony. So from Plastic EP and Anthony Robustelli, you make sure you go and buy that book. I want to tell you, because I'll tell you what, after you read that, you'll know everything. Watch your Anthony.
Thanks a lot, man. Nice talking to you.
Pleasure. All the best.